Okay, I'm ready. I'm walking into the fire wind tunnel. This is crazy.
Fire is something that human beings have been experiencing for our entire existence. And it's been estimated that people have been using fire for 400,000 years, 500,000 years. But that doesn't actually mean we understand it. Okay, think about that entire span of human history where we've used fire successfully, and now only recently in that entire time frame, we thought, well, it's necessary to try to remove it.
This is the Fire Sciences Lab in Missoula, Montana. Researchers at the lab have spent the past 5 decades studying fire and developing new models for fire behavior and warning systems. There are so many variables that influence how fire acts. In the lab, scientists are able to strip those variables down to examine them one at a time, whether it's wind speed, slope, airflow, or anything else that influences flames. That allows them to study fire in intimate detail.
So I'm gonna spray a little line of alcohol here just to get us a good ignition, okay?
All right.
All right, ready?
Ready.
All right.
Whoa.
As smart as most human beings are, we're still not smart enough to understand fire without playing with it. And you have to actually have hands-on experience with fire in order to discover how it works.
All right. I feel like I'm instinctively already stepping back from this, but I'm gonna trust you here. Wow.
And so the cool thing about this is that the frequency of this puffing is only related to the diameter of the pan. Here, this is about twice per second. But big forest fires, really big ones, they will puff with an interval of about 30 seconds or
really?
Even longer. Yeah, the bigger the fire, the slower it puffs.
This laboratory here in Missoula, Montana, it's here precisely because of the history of fire here in the Northern Rockies since 1910.
In the world of firefighting, 1910 is a year that lives in infamy. That summer, a monstrous wildfire dubbed the Big Burn charred 3 million acres of land on the Montana-Idaho border. The 1910 Big Burn changed how Americans view fire. Fire became a scourge and something to be beaten back. It ultimately led to a Forest Service policy called the 10 a.m. rule. It called for fire to be put out by 10 a.m. the day after it was spotted. But the policy had unintended consequences.
Our intuition is not just a little wrong. It's not like 10% wrong. It's exactly wrong.
That intuition to put fires out allowed fuel to build up in the forests, priming them for explosive fires. One of those happened in 1949 when the Mann Gulch fire blew up to 3,000 acres, the equivalent of nearly 4,000 football fields in just 10 minutes. It killed 13 firefighters and sparked the realization that we might not know what we're up against when it comes to fire. That led to the creation of the Fire Lab, which in turn created radical shifts in policy, including one to let fires burn.
Fighting it harder actually makes it worse. That's called the fire paradox, where the harder you try to remove fire, the worse it gets when it does happen, and it's because we're accumulating fuel across the landscape that otherwise would be removed by combustion, right? We're saving it for the worst case conditions. And I would say that a lot of what we need to do in the future is learn better how to accomplish the other aspects of fire management. Allowing fires to burn, working with fire as a tool on the landscape, and better assessing risks to different places.
We're gonna go in and just walk briskly by the burner so we get upwind of it.
Okay, we won't be upwind.
And then we can kind of hang out and talk and.
Okay. You said there is a little bit of wind in here right now.
Yeah, it doesn't feel like it.
But no, but there's a little, there's just a nice gentle breeze.
Yeah, the flames are very low density, so it doesn't take much to push them around.
So this in particular is used to look at what effect the size of the fire has on the burning behavior. Really, really wide fires tend to have really, really wide plumes of smoke above it and mimic it in the lab by using a simple chimney. Air can't come in above the fire. So all of the air that comes in to replace all that's the smoke that's rushing up has to come in down on the ground.
If you get some air, a blob of air that's slowly spinning over a large area, if you can somehow concentrate that into a smaller area, it has to spin faster to contain the same amount of energy.
Right.
Same thing happens with a figure skater ice skating. Right, you know, they have their arms out or in and they can control their spin rate. So once it gets going, it can last for a long time.
Yeah,
in the field, we've seen over an hour these things last. It's possible.
What's it like talking with like firefighters that have dealt with these in the field? You know, how are you building those relationships and those connections?
So I was a firefighter when I started. When I was 18 years old, I worked on a fire crew for the Forest Service, and I've continued to go out as a firefighter. And so that, combined with the interactions that we have through training and stuff, I think really helps us generate tools and knowledge that can help them out in the real world.
The researchers don't just light things on fire in the lab. In the field, they examine real-world fire situations to test their models and design new ones. The Lolo Peak fire burned in 2017, roughly 20 miles from the lab's doorstep.
Here we are, we're looking at
the Lolo Peak fire. Yeah, it started in early July, and then essentially very small fire when it was detected, but in a really remote area that's actually part of the wilderness. So the decision makers here have a hard choice at that point, right? They can choose to send firefighters into a place that could be extremely unsafe. And essentially a firefighter could die just trying to put the fire out small. Mm-hmm. Or they can take a bigger approach and they can say, we can use this fire as a way to basically restore fire to a landscape that needs it. We know because it hasn't burned for well over 100 years. But to do that, we're trading one risk for another.
Millions of Americans already live in or near forests across the West. As the climate changes, the potential for explosive large fires is only likely to grow. That will change our relationship with the landscape, and it only makes the work that Mark and his crew at the fire lab are doing more vital.
Humans have contributed a great deal to the wildfire disasters that we see now. And that also means that humans can undo that kind of contribution to this disaster. We can make it actually safer. We can mitigate a lot of this. Fire disasters don't have to happen. Fires have to happen, but fire disasters don't have to happen.